So that cut cover that you mentioned that got some people kind of, you know, a bit vexed and stuff. Was that just like a spontaneous thing? Like, okay, we're gonna do this.
Yeah, but
thing.
That's a famous story. By now, that should be that everyone should know this in their diary how
right,
the album was made. Very simple. We were recording in the country, which we've never been in England for a long time, like that, just in the middle of nowhere in the studio, and there was nothing but mud and food around us and grass, you know. So photographer came, wanted to take pictures. They said. Probably for the album, possibly could have been something like that, and we just on the spare of the moment. Okay, let's just do something tribal. Let's get something going, muddy or something, you know. And then we probably thought that wasn't enough. Probably it built up from maybe just doing the faces, and then we just said, let's just roll in the mud, or let's just all roll in the mud all together, and that was it.
It's so funny because you say it like it is, and it was like the most natural. Okay, of course, the next logical step is we're gonna roll around.
It made really logical sense to us, but at the time, again in 1979, you got to think of John Travolta, how the world looked, you know,
right?
How people looked. Not that John Travolta wasn't cool; he was cool, and the movie was cool. But just the audience in general was just basically geared to heavy metal or soft rock, normal rock, or whatever rock, the hippie rock was left over, and all that disco stuff, and how they looked, their mentality, what they were into.
Right.
And there was no way that people could even fathom what we were doing.
Right.
Mud or no mud.
Right.
It doesn't matter whether we were in the mud or not. We were just completely alien. People couldn't grasp what it was. Not even Dennis was mixing, Dennis Bovell, and he had a hard time with us running around naked. without a second thought of that there's a whole bunch of guys there, and we just, of course, didn't have any sex or no boyfriend there. We're just working with the boys there, and we were just happy working on the album, and we didn't think, oh, there's somebody going to look at us as sexual or anything.
Were you and are you, you know, this special kind of music in a way called women's music?
Yeah, I guess that it is a very female thing without us deliberately being female and deliberately being segregated. Because we were never about segregation, right? We were always involved with boys, whether sexually or relationship-wise, but especially musically. Boys were never shut out.
Right.
And our fans was always an extended Slits family of fair amount. You can even see it in gigs now. It's boys and girls of all ages, you know,
right,
of all culture. So that's how it's supposed to be. So, because we're not about segregation, and we also never deliberately said we're women's lib.
Right.
We were never about feminist movement, you know.
Right.
We even apparently offended the women's lib with the Cut album cover. Apparently some people really upset some women, you know.
Oh, yeah.
But the thing is, we did more for maybe women than a lot of women's lib did, because we weren't specifically politically, we were never politically women's lib, but we were very feminine, female by nature, sexy by nature too,
right,
you know. We were just female and didn't really oppress our female thing,
right.
But at the same time, we revolutionized for females because we were just so out, try to uncondition ourselves from what society said we should be, you know. Really, it's like a deconditioning process going on systematically. Every day there was like, I'm not going to be conditioned to what this magazine says we should look like. Or I'm not going to be conditioned to the music we should be sounding like to this week. Or I'm not going to be conditioned to what my boyfriend or what my mother or my father expects or my family or my friends expect I should look like, do like, feel like, sound like, you know? Every day was like, no, we're not like that. That's even why we probably did that tribal thing, you know, because we wanted to strip down everything that this world, this society was teaching women they should be at that time specifically, you know.
Right, right.
And then we stripped it down, and then we just said, let's just do something tribal and contribute it to being tribal women, like whether that's from back in the ancient Celtic times or African or Native American or whatever, tribal, some tribute to that feeling, you know. And even our music became more and more like that.
Right.
And even in Return of Giant Slits, you can hear that it's more and more tribal sounding and world music, the first sort of type of, before world music even existed, or there was a label of world, there was no label of world music yet.
Right.
Right? Well, so we played that without knowing, just by being really tribal and being into all kind of ethnic culture and ethnic groups, indigenous people, and defending with lyrics too, indigenous people. Like,
yeah.
Walkabout is totally about indigenous people's rights, you know?
Yeah.
Because of that movie we watched, Australian Aborigine movie, Walkabout.
Yeah.
It's a movie, you have to see it if you didn't.
No, I've seen it, yeah.
Right, and that's what the song was about.
Yeah.
The lyrics was a tribute to that, and then we had a lot of songs like Face Place that was all about getting rid of all that paranoia of you had to wear, women couldn't get out on the street without being obsessed with makeup at the time, you know?
Right.
And so it was all that deconditioning about with how girls could just be themselves, and culturally too, like...
Well, it sounded, yeah, what it sounded like on each of these albums, increasingly, you know, after Cut as well, but also Cut, is kind of like you're kind of imagining, you know, kind of a place to, you know, to be free as women. And,
totally, you know. And you know what? We literally did it because we were filming ourselves in the deserts and in the places in America. There's so many beautiful spots, you know.
Yeah.
New Mexico, Arizona, whatever, all over the place. Filming ourselves, take pictures. Some photos where even you can see them now. You look at old photos.
Yeah, Death Valley.
Death Valley stuff, and you know, to show that connection to the earth and to, but with without being hippies still, you know, we weren't really hippie, but we were, and we weren't into organized religions, obviously, either.
Right.
But definitely that, what you just described, to be free girls. Free,
just finding that place.
Finding
that
place. And
yeah.
I took it to a level where I literally lived in Belize and Borneo in the jungle, naked.
Right.
Totally
right.
Naked, like totally living with the indigenous people in Borneo, the Dayak Indian, they were called the Dayaks. And I lived with a tribe there that just had bow and arrows there. They just put it down like a week before we got there. They had like, they were living still hunt. They were, and when we were there, they were still hunting and everything, you know.
Right.
I stayed with the women, with the babies and stuff, because I had my twins there.
Right.
So I was with the kids section, and the guys, my guy at the time, went hunting with the guys.
Wow.
They came back with a fucking ape. It was a woman. Oh my God, her tits were dangling. It was just terrible. Because it looked like a human. God, it was like looking at a dead human, really.
Wow.
What they brought in. It must have been a orangutan or something.
Right.
In Borneo. But it was, it was just shocking.
Right.
But anyway, but they were amazing people, and really, really got me just nearer and nearer to that thing that we wanted to get in the Slits. And it's still music now, and it's still going to be there on stage. It's still with me always.
Right, right.